That feeling when you saw maybe like the first song being played in Germany, in China, in France, how did you manage to do that and what was the feeling behind it?
Well, just echoing on what Ian said before, we never thought from the beginning to be the next big thing. We really are playing this thing from art, soul, and the love. Right? So that is, to me, partly a secret for longevity. Because since you know, I really look, so even when the big thing come, you're still grounded to a certain degree because it means something, but it don't mean end all be all. And after it come, and maybe gone, and maybe never come back to that level again. You still have put your heart and soul in it. Well, let me give you a joke. The first time we heard of any success was we had the Bad Boys from the television, and it was in this company in Sweden that put the record out. And a man came to us one time, binging, banging around Europe, playing, and I think we're in Austria. And the man said, "Man, you guys have a big song in Sweden." We say, "Yeah." But we didn't really put much credence to it because before that, a man said we had a big song, and we check it out, was a group called Inner City, not Inner Circle. So,
Oh.
but when it started really in Sweden, and it mushroomed from Sweden throughout the world. And I always say, I am very happy and grateful that, you know, we have two songs that the world know and the world sing. You can go anywhere in the world and you say, you may not say Inner Circle, and a man may not know, but they know La La Long, I don't know, Bad Boys, Bad Boys, what you gonna do? So, as a man say.
Well, speaking of Bad Boys, can you tell me the inspiration behind the song? Maybe Tyler, can you tell me how the song was written and what he meant and maybe why it was such a big success?
Well, the writer of the song is right there. Ian Lewis is the person who wrote the song, and there was a kid who used to live with us at the time, and we were basically writing about his experience and what we saw him going through. You know, so that was the inspiration for the song. This kid's life, you know what I mean?
So Ian, when you, like, I don't know where you were when you wrote the song, but you're here with your little pen and paper, I guess, and one day you see it in a movie theater or you see it as a TV show, like how do you manage that?
Yeah, we used to love watching movies for real.
Yeah, but you see, the essence of that song is, I mean, some people misconstrue it in the sense they see it on cops and think it's a police song, but
Yes,
it's
that
not
is true.
about that, it's about life. You know, it's like kids in the home fighting the parents, you know, vice versa, kids in the street. If you keep doing stupidity, it's gonna catch up to you. So it's not a matter of, I mean, it was used in that context and people know it in that context. If they listen to the song more and understand it. I mean, if you watch the Martin Lawrence movie, they say, "Bad boy, what you gonna do? I wanna sing the other part, scare them, scrunch, 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 scrunch," then they come back to the chorus because basically that's what everybody knows. But if they listen to the words and see what it's saying, then they
But
will see, you
it's
know.
life repeating itself over and over, you know. Because when we were growing up, our parents and my father said, hey, got you 1 year's come out. And then when you have your kids now, you
Same
tell them,
thing,
got you
same
1 year's
thing.
come out. So,
So it's non-stop.
Yeah, there's non-stop. It's true. It's a very valid point. And I mean, people see that, you know, where sometimes they should check. It's the system that bad. It's not the kids. If they change the system, then the system might change the kids. But if we keep the same system, you know what I mean?
So what about today's song? When you write them, do you still get inspired by maybe the life in the island in Jamaica? Or like, where do you get your inspiration from?
It's just everyday instances, you know what I mean? And you see things happen and, you know what I mean? We're not big like club people, like go to a club and some people write a song, they see a nice girl in the club dance and get an inspiration.
That's not bad either. Let's go, let's go. That's all right.
But I was saying, you know, it's sometimes you go into yourself and you reflect from what you're feeling inside, you
Well,
know
the
what I
world
mean?
have enough to any man can penetrate and meditate upon today. I think the world is way rougher than when I was growing up, man. Things,
Yeah, very
especially for the
true.
kids now. You know, yes, you have the internet, they can reach out the blog and the tweet and this, but everybody gets some mechanical, man. The vibe is not there man to man and person to person anymore. Even sometimes you go to a restaurant and you watch a family. Every single kid but not even
True.
you know
I do it too. I
no,
know.
nobody
Yeah,
per
so
personal
impersonal. I
communication.
mean, you know, mother don't talk to daughter because daughter, maybe boyfriend calls, she gone over the corner and,
She might
you
be
know what I
talking
mean?
to her mom right beside her and I text her.
What do you think about today's music in Jamaica, from dancehall to the new wave of reggae? What do you feel is still in touch with maybe like social issues or?
Yeah, but understand one thing, you know, when you say dancehall music, you know, dancehall is where the music is played. Mm-hmm. You understand me? Whatever music play in the dancehall is dancehall music, or people dancing to the music. So the terminology, and a lot of people don't understand, reggae music is different from dancehall in the sense that dancehall is more a mix. Like, for instance, you ever heard of calypso music?
Yes.
Well, calypso, you have soca, yes, which is a mixing of soul and calypso. Mm-hmm. You understand? So they mix it up. Before, calypso was slow with the strum. Now it's...
Now,
right. So it's the same thing with reggae.
You yeah, but see, in the dance hall, you know, when you speak to a Jamaican who know it, or Jamaican, or anybody who really into that, mm-hmm, it's a dance hall. When you go to a dance hall, you know, it's more than likely it's the sound. I'm going to talk over the sound, like rapping and talk, and sing the song. So it's not like maybe going to a party where the record is just played one song after the other song after the other song. So coming out of the dance hall is a whole different kind of vibe than regular parties, yeah, or, you
it's
know.
Songs which you would normally hear on the radio and done
right
in that style. Understand?
And
to suit that audience.
What about the lyrics, the difference of lyrics maybe between reggae, like what you were explaining
put
earlier
it this way, in the dance hall, man literally invent on the spot, yeah, you know.
Impromptu.
Like I read him playing and a man just grab the mic and just say, oh, this what you want to sing, and then you grab the mic and you give your interpretation. And if it's a good interpretation,
yeah, YouTube,
the crowd raves.
Yeah, but you still have like a dancehall music or dancehall artists from Vice Cartel to Movado.
Yes.
You still have like the records coming
out.
So.
That is the system they pretty much come out of.
Mm-hmm. So what is different with the music that you do today? You do reggae and you still have the message behind your music?
Well, it after reggae without a message. Mm-hmm. There's two things that make reggae. The bass line and the message. If you don't have them two things, it's not reggae music. Because basically, the players that early players that played reggae music was jazz musicians. And when they went, just some same thing with Motown. Motown had jazz musicians playing the music. So reggae right music was the same thing. So when the improvisation come from it, they listen to the singer. So the singer will sing and the musicians find the music.
And
now
the vibe.
Somebody just sit to the computer and
I believe that over a period of time, if you look at the political climate in Jamaica from the 50s coming up, I mean, and so the political climate changed, so the music changed. In the 50s, we had the influence of the American radio stations.
What influence America? I think you know, same influence in Jamaica too.
You know, so we had that boogie-woogie thing coming up. And out of that, we had our calypso, mento, all that stuff,
yeah,
you know, scat there, which was a happier time. In the 60s, Jamaica got independence in 1962. Things got a little bit harder because we didn't have all those pounds coming from Britain anymore.
Well, even when it was coming, it was not that great. But let me tell you something. Our music always been influenced by African R&B music from America. Yeah. Always. Because if you look at even Bob Marley, when they had the Wailers,
yes,
the group the Wailers yeah together, in the early time it was R&B feel.
Curtis
soul
Mayfield
afro
was one of
suit.
Biggest,
mm-hmm. The
yeah,
same.
I'm a rebel, soul
I'm a
rebel.
Soul, you know, the same. So we have always been very influenced. And not only that, we've been always influenced by the struggles that happen here
yeah
in America. And it maybe happened in a little bit different way in Jamaica, but it's the same struggle. Poor against the rich oligarchy and so on and so on.
And people like Marcus Garvey. You know, people don't know how Caribbeanized America is. Stokely Carmichael was from Trinidad. I mean, you have
our
to go in.
Parents
you have to
from
go
the
into
Caribbean.
History. It's similar like with Haitian history. You had
yeah
Bookman and you had
Toussaint
Louverture.
Right.
So it's the Caribbean been influencing for a long time. Even with Cuba, it's
right
the Cuba African rhythm. So
even Cuba,
you know
all Latin America,
is
everything there.
Music
the food
is an international language.
Yeah.
You know? Also producers. You have a great studio, I think one of the best in the US from what I heard. how do you help upcoming artists? Like, do you think it's important to, you know, inspire the youth and help them, or even artists already renowned?
Well, doing this thing for a long time, mm-hmm, you find really two categories. You have people who born naturally with it,
yeah,
with it.
Talent, just habit.
Just naturally, whatever they do. And then you have the other ones who can be molded. You understand me? And it's just like, you know, mom would say, oh, my daughter can't sing. But deep down, she know the daughter can't sing, but she will put as much resources, hence something called auto-tune. So auto-tune was born to save so many people, because if you strip them down and say, let's go.
So are you against or for auto-tunes? Do you think it's something that's going to kill the music industry?
Auto-tune wasting people time, man. Because literally, if you go to a show, you're not you're not experiencing the artist. I mean, young people, everybody have the genre and the life. You can't, you know, nobody's here to knock that. But true talent, you have to just do it naked. Just say, go, give me something.
But do you think nowadays the audience actually have the ear for true talent? Do you think they still recognize real music?
That's a very good point. It's true. Because what we really have in this business, you know, is not singing business. We have the entertainment business.
Yes, exactly.
So if you can go out and entertain, even if you cannot sing very well, I can name a few people who begin the business who we have their a cappella, and if you don't want to hear it, cannot sing to save them life.
A but nice lady like you, can you sing?
Here we go.
we could make you.
Here we go. So after the show, we can start talking.
Once you have the look.
You have to have the look.
Once you got the look, because
no, it's true. Like entertainment, and you have the real
talent.
That's
what it is. Somebody want to sell a car, they put a pretty girl, they put a nice song behind it, and
package.
And that's what it is. You know what I mean? Not to fight, and we're not here fighting.
No, of course, but it's a reality.
We're just giving you the facts. You say you want new artists. If you are a new artist out there and you really believe you have talent, work on your craft. Work on it. You just take a couple, little 2 evenings ago, music lessons. You know, learn what pitch is, play a little keyboard. That when you come to the table, you can bring your music out more.
I believe talent always shine through, though. If you look at people like Alicia Keys, for one, Lady Gaga.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, very
classically
talented
trained,
people,
can play the piano. I respect her, though. I respect Gaga,
you know?
For real.
So you have to look at that and say, talent wins every time. Plus, she has a package to go with it.
Definitely. Well, on the last note, I know you're performing in Miami. So where will it be and when? At the Arts Center.
That's
on
right.
February.
You can pronounce it better than I can. The Arts Center.
Arts Center, yes.
The Adrian Arts Center.
The February 24th, correct?
Right. It's just going to be what we call a reggae jam, which we want to give people an experience. Come sit down.
Church. You
have to dress up. If you want to wear your shorts, you know what I mean? We ain't
come to dance, come to listen, and come to enjoy yourself, because it's going to be rocking, boom, 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 boom.
Well, on that note, thank you very much for being with us today, and we're looking forward to see you at the Arts Center then.
Well, we're looking forward to see you at the Arts Center.
Yes, and in 5 months, I'm going to be a superstar.
Okay.